fast, die young, bad girls do it well. Live fast, die young, bad girls do it well. Live fast, die young, bad girls do it well. Hello and welcome to The Dollhouse. My name is Kit Kowalski. I'm an Australian feminist researcher and blogger. I'm joined by my co-host, Evie Wyatt, who writes for The Spectator and whom you can also find on Substack. We're here to talk about sex, gender, and all the nonsense in the Antipodes. How's it going this week, Edie?
I'm doing well. Yeah, I'm, fighting on the tweets, and I'm writing in the magazines, and I'm talking to the women's on Spaces.
You just had another article in The Spectator come out, didn't you?
I did, yes. I just did a review of Graham's book, Tough Crowd, which I very much enjoyed.
Yeah. Oh, that's good, yeah.
I didn't want to – it's funny, you know, when you write something and you're on the same side as someone and you don't want to kind of blow smoke, but the man can write, and he writes in a particular way, and it's not sort of a standard biography, because it is kind of an activist book. So I don't see anything wrong with that. I mean, we get activist books all over the place. It's nice to get one from the other side. Yeah. So I did that.
I think I think he's pretty chuffed with the response that it's getting. I think it's one of those things. He's probably — I've seen a couple of tweets from Graham Linehan, and he seems to be happy that people are buying the book, but I think people seem to be loving it or hating it regardless of whether or not they actually enjoyed reading it. So I think that must be pretty frustrating. I think I'm not a great creator, but I think it is frustrating when you do something and people react to you rather than to what you've done.
Yeah, well, you can see that in the reviews, and I think my review was more of a review of the reviews.
Yeah,
some of them, they're just nasty and mean and corrupt. They're not taking it seriously. They're just saying, well, he's this evil person, we crucified him, and we're not backing down, because they're the ones that did it, right? They're the ones that have made him persona non grata and made it so he can't work in his job. I guess I'm sympathetic with him, but I also wanted to highlight that he has sort of gone into this because of who he is. When you read a biography, you do get a glimpse into someone's — who they are and how they see the world, where they sit.
Yeah, I always enjoy getting his — he does it was weekly, but I don't know if it is strictly weekly, Substack blog, and that comes out as an email called This Week in the War on Women. And, you know, there was a time there where we were getting them a couple of times a week, actually, and it was just, you know, hundreds if not thousands of words and pictures of stories from around the UK and from around the world, research, exposés, putting evidence together. Not all done by him. I think he's got a couple of people who work with him and help him out. I found that a really useful tool. Yeah. And it's clear that he's got some sort of white knight thing happening. He's definitely
he's got a certain personality. He's got a sort of personality as well, and he's a prolific creator. I'm a writer, not sort of his level, but I recognize the nature of the person who has to — that I watched the thing on, I don't know who it was, Hemingway, one of the big writers, and they said there's something narcissistic about a writer who makes — where they think that the world — they have something interesting to say, and that people, by definition, if you're writing something, you think that you
have — there's a reader, right?
That's right. And you think you have an interesting contribution. And I do think that. So I saw that in myself. There is a little bit of It's unavoidable. Political commentators, they all think that they've got something to say. And that's something we're going to cover this week as well. We've seen on X, there's a conflict within our own little gender critical world and a fallout from what we talked about last week about the GenSpec conference and the autogynophile that was put on there. Kind of
tweets.
They've taken that tweet down.
Interesting.
Yeah. And they've removed his book from the recommended reading. It's this week we've had a bit of a more revelation of the gentleman in question. He's been on all the podcasts, all the Centrists have welcomed him with open arms. But it turns out he has got quite a serious paraphilia. And it's a little bit creepy. That's a bit surprising, isn't it?
It is interesting how that debate sort of erupted and evolved, and it seems to have coalesced on the side of those who are outraged. And I found it very interesting. So do you want to give a quick recap of what happened with Phil Lilly, the AGP at GenSpec?
Well, I think the debate, because they got piled on, right, the gender critical presence on Twitter is quite extensive. And so they got this feedback, and some of it wasn't very polite. And so they sort of cried a bit of victimhood, which is fine. It's not nice to be piled on. And so the White Knights came in. Some of the Centrists, James Lindsay was one of them. I think Colin Wright as well came defending the views of the centre, and I'll talk about that later. But the women in the gender critical movement, some of them went one way and some went the other. But those of us who have been in for a long time, there's no question for us about whether we're going to team up with an autogynephile. You know, this is out of bounds. And so James has said, look, it's hilarious that all these rad firms are sort of going off because they made transgenderism. And we've got this narrative that comes from the men's rights activist side that it's all women's fault, especially transgenderism.
That is rule one of misogyny.
Yes.
So I think there's like 14 rules of misogyny, and that's the first one, is it's always a woman's fault.
That's right, yeah. And, you know, James Lindsay is he's got a PhD in mathematics, then he was a massage therapist, and he's come into this area sort of studying all the things, some of the theorists that I studied, and I took some sort of he got my attention early on. He did that. They had those grievance studies things where they published some papers and submitted them to very progressive or woke humanities department and got some of them peer-reviewed. They didn't get all of them, and some of them, and my sort of census was pricked there a little bit too, because some of them they didn't get through. And he said, I saw him in interviews, he said, oh, he didn't realize that there was rules to the humanities. So I thought, hang on, I thought was under the false impression that he had studied.
An academic
of some sort.
Yeah.
But then I realized he doesn't actually understand any of the theories. And I would say things like, but he doesn't really understand Foucault. He doesn't really understand Marxism. He doesn't. And of course he blocked me for saying that 2 years ago now. So I haven't had him, thankfully, in my feed for a while. And he's kind of taken this idea that all this comes from the academia. It's all come from them, and that's originated feminism. He thinks he's a real genius because he tracks all these ideas back to, he finds German romanticism in the ideas of Western political thought, which is steeped in German political theory, right? And he talks about, you know, the different schools and all the rest of it and how this evil has emerged. He's not a very big thinker, I'm sorry. Anyway, so Kelly J has come out and said, women didn't invent narcissistic, perverse men getting erections in dresses. You know, she doesn't kind of mince the words. And he said, it would be a mistake to pick this fight with me. It would be wiser to let it go or be mad somewhere else.
Oh.
And we've seen all these, you know, she says, are you suggesting I should be afraid of you? Seems a little sinister. So he's put this threat out. Right? I don't. He's obviously underestimated the fan base of Kelly J. Keene. I mean, these women, what they lack in numbers, because he's got quite a big following, but what she might lack in numbers in terms of in relative terms, I would say that the feminists make up for enthusiasm, or the women's rights activists make up for enthusiasm. And so he got a little bit of a lesson on the tweets from a variety of women. I don't think it's been a very happy week for him. I think that would be.
But he didn't just pick a fight with Kelly J. Keene. He also picked a fight with Genevieve Gluck and Anna Slatz, who are the editors-in-chief of Redux, which is the premier reader-funded publication pushing back against gender ideology feminist in the West.
That's right.
And Genevieve Gluck, you know, literally she did the research. She is the one who has done all of the digging on the origins of transgenderism.
That's right.
She's our generation's Janice Raymond, almost.
That's right. It has to be mentioned that Janice Raymond, these radical feminists, when did the Transsexual Empire come out? Was it 1979. So, you know, this they've been pushing about back about this stuff since before James was born, or maybe when he was born. He's about that era, isn't it? So all his life, these women have been dedicated to being pushing against this stuff. Mm-hmm. And he's turned up and says, "Oh, your fault, ladies." And then he said to Genevieve Gluck, said something, blaming radical feminists for this is the most egregious gaslighting and Darvo. The slur TERF was specifically made to attack feminists for opposing gender identity ideology. GI comes from sexology and psychology. And he says to her, "What is a woman?" Which is the gotcha question that feminists invented. He doesn't even know. He doesn't even know what a radical feminist is.
Is this whole episode just going to be us laughing at James Lindsay? Because I'm here for it.
Yeah, it is. He's such a fucking idiot. Sorry, I might edit that out. So then we say, they say, because they wrote this book. I read the book. I was going to write a view on it, but I was too lazy because it was terrible. James Lindsay, Helen Puckross, and Peter Boghossian, is it Boghossian, wrote this book, Cynical Theories, about the rise of critical theory. And even when I read it, it just didn't seem very intelligent. And so I got online and I thought, maybe I misunderstand it. Maybe in the years I've left the academic world, that there's been other developments and I haven't fully understood. So I'm always keen to listen to people. So I followed him. I followed Helen Pluckrose. And one day in 2020, she came up with this tweet, which says, "Seriously, I'm generally more concerned about trans people who really are a marginalized group who face a lot of abuse, prejudice, and discrimination just for being trans. While I don't believe women to be marginalized or face much abuse, prejudice, or discrimination for being women." And I thought, what are you talking about, lady? And that's when I said, oh, hang on. And in that thread, I met my friend Julio, whose tweet I might show later, and a few other gay men, Fred Sargent, who'd been following me for a while. And that's when my friend Julio said to me, all the men's rights activists were going rah, rah, and I thought, hang on, what are the men's rights activists doing aligning with the trans? And that's where my friend Julio said, there's a fine line between an MRA and a TRA, and it's drawn with an eyebrow pencil. And I quote that quite often because it was a moment I went, oh, of course. It was like the scales left, and I could see these people are not, they're not serious thinkers. They're not really trying to get to the bottom of this, because what they've done is podcasting becomes a market, and all this kind of commentary on the internet, independent commentary, and they've all gone for the men's rights activists who have the same kind of objective as trans rights activists in destroying feminism. So they discredit us, they try and take our boundaries, and Helen is this kind of woman who wants to make this halfway. And that's the new centrist. They want to make the halfway. They want to say, But there's no halfway between women being women and women being not women, you know, and gender performance actually turning someone into a woman. It's a nonsense. So I made this, pointed this out this week, and Helen's come at me saying that she still doesn't believe that women are particularly disadvantaged. No, I still don't think women are particularly disadvantaged or oppressed. Sorry. So they try and suggest that we are using oppressive frameworks, but actually they are doing identitarian. We have women as a sex class, right? That's the concept of feminism, is that women as a class of sex, are oppressed relative to men and by men.
And a class really just means that we have some common characteristic that you can use to group us together. Right?
That's right.
Like a class doesn't mean anything special. Like you can have the class of people with brown eyes or the class of people with blue eyes who are at risk of, I think, macular degeneration, right? So
it's from the word classification.
Yeah, it's a class. You just can group them together and you can say, look, you've got these risks and these benefits, and you can analyze people based on a class. So women are a sex class.
And we think it's a very significant class, that male and female are very significant classes.
Yeah.
And they're important to recognise in law and society for the protection of women and girls. So when you have a single sex. Sorry?
It's that simple. Like that's really the basis of it.
That's right.
Yeah.
And feminism is a political action for the protection of women and girls. That's all, as a sex class, females as a sex class. That's all it is.
Yeah.
So we're trying to do this. And she comes along and she says, this is Helen Pluckrass, I do recognise women as a class, or more accurately as a sex, one of two. I'm going to mute you. This is probably at the end. You are showing that you do not want to hear about sex offenders, what factors increase the likelihood of a boy or a man becoming one, and what behaviours are indicators of high risk. And she did block me. I don't know why she's unblocked me now. I don't know why. You just want to bash men and snipe at me. It's a waste of time to try and get to read anything, because she wants us to read material. I read a book. That's all I'm reading. I'm done with reading you, sweetie. And she wants us to read these big long threads, and she's just pasted one, which is it's so dumb. I don't want to be arrogant, but this is not intelligent. This is not a highly intelligent person. So what she's trying to do, and what she was trying to do with you and I on the tweets, was to try and bring us into a narrative where we're going to stop rape and sexual offence by fixing men. That was going to be the front line of it. She started to tell me about all the things that lead to men becoming rapists, and that I should focus on them rather than on men, women and girls as a sex class, as females.
This is where something I do actually want to pick up, because I was in this conversation with her as well, and she... what sort of happened was I'm actually very interested in the factors. I do think it's really interesting, and we should be investigating and addressing the factors that cause men and boys to become sex offenders. I think absolutely not all men are rapists, like not all men are sex offenders. Let's look at the factors and let's try to reduce them. So we know that childhood sexual abuse is a huge factor. Okay, yep. Great. Let's stop that. Let's stop that. We're absolutely against it. However, there's another part of this, which is that we as women don't know which reasonable, normal, ordinary looking, sounding and seeming men possess these factors. We don't know. And what we do know is that a lot of men who have these risk factors and who have every intention of harming a woman or a girl or a male child even, we know that men who have those intentions are capable of seeming normal in order to get past safeguardings.
Yes.
And even to the point of enrolling in a degree and playing the game and entering a career and playing the game and getting into a supervisory role and waiting and biding their time for years and years and years.
Some men became priests. to take advantage. That's a lot of work.
So we know that, like, some of these people they'll put the hard yards in. Yeah. So there's two things there. One is stopping the men from experiencing the risk factors or mitigating them or giving them therapy or whatever it happens to be.
Yeah.
And then the other side is let's protect the women and the girls and the boys.
There is another factor here as well, which are cultural indicators, cultural conditions which lead to abuse. And we talk about that with Caitlin Roper as well, which we'll play next week. And we talk about that, you know, governments talk about that in terms of primary prevention. They talk about conditions which create entitlement in men, misogyny, so what we would call rape culture. So she came to a point where she was actually arguing with me, which is where she blocked me. I said, well, I'm happy to talk about rape culture if you want. But it turns out she didn't. Because what she's using there is actually a progressive left-wing argument. It's about gender, because the cultural meanings of society give to sex are gender. That's what we call them. And so she started to actually mount what is an oppressive framework in culture. But she was trying to suggest that women had to take some responsibility for male pattern violence and fixing male pattern violence, but only concentrating on men, not in the protection of women and girls.
Mm.
So it's a very dangerous argument. And someone noted that I was quite heated with her, and still now my language towards her is not temperate, because it's dangerous. And she's teamed up with people like James Lindsay, who is a men's rights activist. I mean, those people are playing to the likes. They're getting, there's a market dynamic going where they can get the likes and follows. And we saw that as we started to engage with her, the low quality of the people that were defending her. It wasn't her mate who's an academic at, you know, Stanford University coming in. It was these 7 follower scrody men who, you know, just say the same talking points. You know, I hate men. And even her, she said that your motivation, she accused me of that my motivation was that I hated men, that I wanted to really rubbish men. And I said to her, you know, I came into this, I put my Quillette article. This is why I came to this, is because I'm a survivor. I'm interested in the protection of women and girls. That's my motivation. And for you to suggest that my motivation is that I hate men is actually deeply offensive to me. So,
well, I mean, look, we're probably 2 of the bigger, you know, male defenders, I think, you know, aren't we really? Like, you know, we're pretty big on giving men an even go, I think.
I think we're very fair, to the point where I certainly get criticism of that, and certainly with my friendships online with some men. I don't mean to suggest that kind of friendship, but, you know, they're mostly gay men. So it's, you know, it's led to this conversation where I feel like the centrists have come out, and then finally it's been going to and fro, and someone said, well, what can women do? Her question was, what? She thought it was such a gotcha question. What can women do? What can men do that women can't? Someone said, well, they can go and walk at night. You know, women can't. And she says, I like to go night walking with a novel on audio for hours. It's my favorite form of relaxation. But I also work night shifts, and why do you need to go out anyway is irrelevant. So she's trying to suggest, kind of like a lib femme would, that, you know, kind of a reclaim the night. Anyone suggesting that we can't walk out at night is restricting the freedom of women. It's a very, for someone who is against liberal feminism, her arguments are very steeped in liberal. And that's what I thought about the book. I thought this is just a form of kind of progressive humanist liberalism. It's not. They're just trying to give us a model. They're not, which is what I think what centrism has been. It's like they they kind of just want to make up a new political theory without actually giving any credit to the ones that have been kind of in the genuine political and rigorous academic scholarship, which has been in the academy for a long time and has been marginalized by the capture. So James has come out, I think it was today, where he's come out with his famous little thing, "Dumb feminist hags think they can struggle me. They don't get it. I just don't care about them. I don't respect them. I don't like them. They're powerless over me. It's a joke and fun for me to mock and expose." And he's retweeted someone who his little minions have probably piled on. And she's come back. "Nice try, but I'm a dude." "I know you don't like women. It's obvious from every post of yours that I have unfortunately read." So he's assumed that this is a woman, but it's not. And he says, "You're still a dumb feminist hag and a bitch and wrong and vile, lol." So we can say that James lost his little, sense today.
He's definitely lost his rag. He's chucked the toys out of the pram, and he's blocked a whole bunch of women who he thinks of as feminists. And I think it's probably time for me to, you know, air my main concerns about James Lindsay. Now, you know, I know he's probably listening. It's probably hanging on at every word that we utter. Look, I've had a few conversations about him, and I was really interested when I first heard about him a few years ago, because I'd heard about the grievance studies affair, and I thought, oh, it was really cool and interesting, and that, you know, it's this fun thing. A couple of rat bags got together, and they submitted some terrible abstracts to it, like some hoax abstracts to academic journals, and they got them published, and then they drew some conclusions out of that. And, you know, it's quite funny. And I saw some panel discussions with James Lindsay, Peter Boghossian, and Helen Pluckrose, and they make some good points. They, you know, Peter Boghossian, I think, is essentially probably, you know, maybe the driving force behind it.
The smart.
Maybe, yeah. But, like, each of them, you know, they carry themselves. But I've always seen he's quite arrogant, and, you know, for example, his critique of he made this critique of intersectionality, which people will know that I sort of have quite a critique of. But his critique of intersectionality wasn't necessarily that it was wrong, right? But that because he has a degree in mathematics, he finds it a really simple concept, the idea that, you know, you've got sets that can intersect, and it's not a very hard thing to get your head around. You know, so that's his critique, is that, you know, set theory is much more, like, it is easy to understand as a mathematical concept. But what I want to say is that the people who talk to me about James Lindsay, they tend to be young men, and they tend not to know a lot about the history of progressive politics, feminism. They tend not to know very much about, like, the revolutionary socialist struggles. They tend not to know very much about the struggles around, like, progressivism, the Vietnam War, you know, how close the world got to, like, a communist revolution. You know, they tend not to know very much about that fairly recent history, you know, that's been happening in the world. And so I will have these conversations with these young men along the lines of, yeah, you know, feminism's really bad. It's just like Marxism. It's all the same. It's all from Gramsci. It's all critical theory. And it's all wrong because it's all Gramsci. And you're like, okay, so what is critical theory? And they can't tell you.
No.
Who is Gramsci? And they can't really tell you. What did he believe in? They can't really tell you. What is radical feminism? And they say, they'll usually latch onto something like, oh, it's, you know, the idea that women want to be better than men or something. Or they'll say something that's patently untrue.
But what were the circumstances in which these theories emerged?
You know, yeah, so what is one of the central tenets of radical feminism? What does the word radical mean? And they can't tell you. But instead they'll sort of put some words together. It's a big word salad. And then they'll say, oh, James explains it really well in his podcast. Why don't you go and listen to it? And I have. I've listened to a couple of his podcasts, and they're
nonsense, because he's not being taught this stuff. You know, I was taught it by academics. I mean, not all the same academics. When I did my humanities degree, I had post-structuralists who taught Foucault. I had Marxists who taught Marx. We had liberals who taught liberalism. You know, they all put their thing forward. They all had a bias. Mm-hmm. They had these, they showed you the history of where they thought and why they thought that their theory was better than others and how you could use that form of analysis. So in the Marxist thing, I did class analysis, and when I did assignments for the post-structuralists, I did Foucauldian sort of genealogies of things. They teach you how these and where these theories came and why the post-structuralists, the circumstances in which the post-structuralists rose in France, and how cultural theory was developed. The way that these theories have then been taken on by government and governmentality is another issue, and not at all investigated in any satisfactory way by James Lindsay, because he just doesn't have the capacity. One person, like, they disregard all the entire history of the humanities and social theory, and then they say, well, this is, you know, even today I wrote a thread because Benjamin Boyce has also been in the thing, and a couple of years ago I had a falling out with him, and he said to me, I said something very simple like, you know, that women have a unique position in feminist theory. You can't do feminist unless you're a woman, really. He said that was a standpoint theory. And I said, no, that's class analysis, you know, which predates standpoint theory, you know, like, you've not got your head around this, you know. And he unfollowed me, and I've since muted him, just by saying, look, you don't understand this. And they can't hear that. Whether they can't hear that from a woman is another issue, but I would say it's probably true. And my take today, his new wife, Benjamin Boyce's new wife, is defending another trans-identified person. These guys are bringing these trans-identified people and saying, they're gender critical, we have to listen to them and engage with them. And we're saying they're performing femininity as a fetish. You can't, you know. Anyways.
Well, isn't that standpoint theory? Like saying that these people have a unique understanding of femininity and feminism because they are trans women?
Well, they would have a unique understanding as a trans experience, which was what my argument was in terms of class, because she's talking about trans people as if they're a class. We don't recognise trans people as a class. There's nothing, like you said, a class has to have a similar, something to bind them. There's nothing to bind what they call trans people. It's nonsense. It's a nonsense class. Yeah, you can't have a class.
I honestly don't think I believe in the true trans. I don't think that you're born trans.
No, I don't believe it either. And I don't. The more you get yourself steeped into here, the less you believe it. And that's, you know, Helen Joyce has gone down that rabbit hole. And even in an interview with Peter Boghossian, he said, I hear you don't believe in this at all. She said, no, it's rubbish. It's nonsense. Mm. There's no natural tendency. These things, these paraphilias and these what they call gender dysphoria, it's just people reacting to culture. You know, extremely gay kids reacting to a conservative culture where they say, well, I'm going to be a woman then if that's the only people who can have men. You know, it's you know, these psychologists have come forward, and Jen Speck is a psychologist conference, and everyone knows I'm a bit cynical of psychology. Not completely, because they've helped me. But I don't think they're going to be our new priests. You know, I don't think they're going to be our saviors, because, like, if this is what this woman says, a radical center is her thing. Julia Malott, which is a trans-identified man, is a kind and intelligent person with admirably nuanced and centrist take on some controversial issues. It was a delight to meet her in person in the conference. And I've retweeted saying, centrism is just a group of unqualified people who think they can make line calls and in-between compromises for other people who have done robust political analysis. They do this based on flawed moral systems of kindness and the myth of progress, same as left progressives. They think that they can go in the center, they can critique the left, what's happening with the institutional capture, which is what we talk about, and the ideology that's captured institutions. They can critique it, but they're using the same tools as we critique it with class analysis. And they critique that by using the progressive tools. And then they use the progressive tools to try and shame us by saying trans people, because the idea that trans people are more progressive, the reason why she pretends that women are not oppressed is that she wants to still maintain the belief that the trans-identified man should have access to women's spaces. So she does that by implying that there's an oppressive dynamic where women can actually be the oppressors of trans people. So that's what they're trying to suggest, that us feminists who are saying we don't think that there's a legitimate class of people, they're trying to put us as the oppressor in that dynamic. So they're using the same techniques that they're critiquing.
Yeah, and this is one of the, this is very reminiscent of intersectional analysis. So, and as we all know, like, it's very easy to game intersectionality if you can cross categories at will. So, you know, intersectionality is the intersection of, opposing pairs, like binary pairs of oppressor and oppressed. So, you know, you have your black, white, your straight, gay, you're rich, you're poor, you're male, you're female. And if you can cross those categories, then you can essentially just, you know, you can game the entire system. And
and the problem is that they're not material categories, which is what we claim sex as a material category. A lot of them are cultural categories. And trans is even worse than that. It's not a cultural category. It's an identity category. It's a pure identity category. So it's only in the declaration that class is made.
Well, I think initially in intersectionality, like according to, you know, very early intersectionality, it was really sex, race and class, right?
Yeah.
And by that, I'm actually talking about the 1975 pamphlet by Selma James titled Sex, Race and Class. Where she talks about she talks about using an intersectional analysis as, and she predates Kimberlé Crenshaw, by the way, with this term, but she talks about using an intersectional analysis to diagnose where we need to, you know, where there might be oppressed people who are falling into multiple or, you know, intersecting, of these known oppressed classes or these known disadvantaged classes, where they might be not being helped, right? So her classic example was you had the workers who had their workers' rights movement, they had the unions, you had women who had the feminist movement, it was mostly at the time being, there was actually a lot of different feminist movements. So there was quite a lot of middle class white academic feminists, but there were also black feminists, and then you had the black liberation movement as well, right?
Yeah.
And she went through and she said, okay, well, you know, the Black Liberation Movement is taking care of, you know, the Black interests. The workers' movement is taking care of the workers' interests, and the women are taken care of by the feminists. But what we tend to find is that in the feminist movement, it's women who are either wealthy, or they don't have children, or they have mm-hmm. a middle-class husband to support them, or they're academic, or they're well off, right? So they're middle class. You know, the workers, that tends to be either dominated by men or by women who are, you know, academic, well off, childless. They have time to go after work to, you know, to participate in worker struggles. And same in the Black Liberation Movement, it tends to be run by men and supported by women who have who don't have families. So what happens if you are a poor Black working class woman, right? What happens is that you're at home looking after the kids, you're doing a job, you're going home, you're doing all of the laundry, you're doing all of the housework, and then you're probably going and making sandwiches and taking them out to the union picnic or to the Black Liberation meeting or whatever, and your needs are not getting met. You're not getting heard in these struggles. Yeah. So she said the women who are in the intersection of these liberation movements are still not being heard and represented. And I think, yeah, okay, great, that's fine. You know, it diagnoses the people that you should be listening to.
Which works particularly with material classes. And I think
yeah.
I think homosexuality is another material class, because I think it's pretty clear that it's innate. Men who have no attraction to women and women who have no attraction to men have been historically discriminated against. So, you know, the trope is the Black disabled lesbian, you know, that you'll see on the comedy programs as the, you know, the pinnacle of intersectional oppression. But it's actually true. If you are a Black, I mean, I'm sure there's very many successful Black disabled lesbians, but those things are going to work against you sometimes, yeah. And so that's a legitimate form of analysis to say that these people need to be cared for by society, which is what, for my money, that's why I study social theory. I wanted to work out how to make the world better. That's why a lot of people enter into social theory. These people engage with political and cultural theory disingenuously. They do it from the start. And even, you know, they talk about the Frankfurt School and cultural Marxism and all the nonsense they go on with. And when you say, well, Weber was in the, you know, in the Frankfurt School, Max Weber, and they blank, they wouldn't even know who he was, you know, and he's one of the third, you know, the Trinity, Holy Trinity of sociology was Marx, Weber, and Durkheim. They only know the ones that James and his anti-woke friends highlight. And so when you say, like, one of the pinnacle sort of works of Max Weber was a paper he called Science as a Vocation. So he talked about the dangers of allowing ideological infection to the humanities. That was a long time ago. I mean, that was before the war. Mm. So I think it was something like 1918 where I wrote that. So these were serious thinkers as opposed to, you know, the people he critiques and throws that name around, like they're nothing like Foucault and Marx and, you know, whoever he talks about in his thing. These guys were from a tradition of thinking, and they were in an increasingly industrializing society that was changing rapidly. The kingdoms were falling, you know, the French Revolution had happened. We had to figure out how to make a good society. And John Stuart Mill, you know, who wrote the seminal work on liberalism. These guys wouldn't know the principles of these ideologies if they bit them in the ass. They just don't understand. And you say to them, well, what about liberalism? You know, because this is causing tyranny. And they want to be the star without having done any of the work. And so, of course, these women come along, like Genevieve Gluck, who's done a huge amount of work on pornography and feminism and has produces the, you know, the biggest publication and bravest publication in the feminist world, only asks her what a woman is. I mean, the guy has got the intellectual capacity of a frog.
I'm always interested in what people, you know, it's all very well to have an analysis, you know, as you and I well know, but I'm always interested in what the solutions yes. that are being offered are. And, you know, when we're looking at, you know, someone like Genevieve Gluck, it's definitely to become armed with knowledge and to assert boundaries and to work together.
That's right.
To resist, right?
Yeah, she's not a radical feminist evangelical person. She's not trying to convert everyone to radical feminism. Most radical feminists who engage in here, and I've had radical feminist pylons, you know, we disagree on a whole bunch of issues, as does yeah. Kelly J. One of the most delightful things was to see him push Kelly J, not push her, but, you know, to come out and say, he said, oh, it's nonsense. Radical feminists didn't cause this. And she's no fan of radical feminism. But even she would say, you know, mate, you're out of order. This nonsense, what you're saying is absolutely not true. So he's doubled down. That's his. It's been sport for us, I guess. But that argument with Helen Pluckrose, I engage in it because we are fighting for the centre, in a sense, because they won't take on they will take on the gender critical arguments, but they won't give the gender critical people any credit, which is what Matt Walsh has done, right? He's taken on the what is a woman concept and some of the gender critical arguments going from gender conservative to gender critical, but he won't give them any credit, not an ounce of it. Because they want the MRA follow.
Yeah, and this is where it does become like really dangerous. Like you really have to be asking when you're following someone online, like what is it that they want you to be doing? What do they want you to do? Right. If the answer is always they want you to listen to another podcast before you'll find the answer, and or purchase something.
I don't have any objection to them making money. I know Kelly J sells her shirts. I've got no criticism of that.
What I'm trying to say is that if you've got someone who is producing like a 2-hour weekly podcast, right, and it's constantly producing content, right, constantly producing content, but his followers can't explain the most basic and simplest and central theme of the arguments, then this is someone whose content is not worth consuming.
No. Right. No.
And
he's not teaching. I think you said he's not teaching his followers anything.
Yeah, they're not being taught. So, like, whereas, you know, Kelly J. Keene, definitely her followers, they learn things. And I used to watch her broadcast almost every day, right? 8:30 in the morning, I'd watch it while I was, you know, having a coffee, sitting down and having a coffee, because she had a lot of news. And yes. There was always a lot of updates and a lot of news, and it was a really good way for me to understand what was going on. And yeah. I saw the way she would educate and teach her audience and how she would come back onto certain themes. And, you know, say what the right approach to things was. And
she's got a lot of loyalty among her followers, her subscribers, which James completely underestimated. I think they've underestimated us. And this, I've got another thread, I don't know how I got into it, today. And the woman who's a American, they're trying to get the conservatives on board, you know. So she leans that sort of conservative way. And she said, oh, the radical feminists will never garner any support because they're too much like TRAs. It's just nonsense. You know, the whole movement has been built with the help of kind of, it's not that it's radical feminism, it's just that it's a tradition of analysis. class analysis and the analysis of the way women are treated in culture, so gender. It's about bringing forward a tradition of research that's a lot of the work's already been done. Well, James pretends to do all the work himself. He pretends that he's gone up to the Mount Sinai and he's got the tablets and figured out, you know, he's cracked the code of where this has all come from. And if we all just kind of fight the feminists and the radical transgenderism, then we're all going to be okay.
One of the conversations around centrism I find really dangerous is that it does seem to be fundamentally anti-feminist. So it casts the centrists, the big C centrists, they cast feminism as being somehow radical, as in dangerous and extreme, right? Mm. So like radical feminism, the radical means to the root, right? It doesn't mean to kill all men. Now, there is a pamphlet called the Scum Manifesto. It was written in 1968 by Valerie Solanas, who was quite a, you know, mentally disturbed young woman. And there's a lot of conjecture, there's a lot of debate about the pamphlet. It said that Scum stands for Society for Cutting Up Men, but apparently that was never stated by her explicitly. I think that was added by a publisher. And there's a lot of debate over the quality of writing, but essentially it begins in this most bombastic fashion that says, you know, life in this society being at best an utter bore. it's so good I've almost memorized it. There remains only to thrill-seeking, civic-minded females to overthrow the money system, introduce complete automation, and destroy the male sex. Mm. So it's like this punchy writing style, this really, you know, interestingly written pamphlet that created a lot of debate and discussion. And it's one of those things you can always bring up because it presents this argument that we'd all be better off if we destroyed all men. And you can have a really good conversation about why or why not. You know, you can talk about that idea because she tries to present it as something that we should do. And then there's conversations about whether or not it was satire or whether or not it's polemic. We bring that up as a thought piece. You know, it's a thought piece, right? It's the only work I'm really aware of that argues strongly to destroy all men. And, you know, I think that there are very few women who are feminists who would genuinely say that that is a realistic solution.
You just need to look at the murder statistics.
Any
you know,
problem.
Women just don't kill men, you know.
No.
Very rarely. You know, it happens, but it's pretty rare. Women generally don't kill other people. It's, you know, murder is and rape are generally male things. So when we talk about the cultural indicators to reduce male pattern violence, we have a serious case. But they don't have any serious case that someone like me is sitting here hating on men, figuring out how to get single-sex spaces back because I just despise men. And that's what they said to me. They said, well, you can't discriminate against an entire class. Well, yeah, we can.
Yes,
that's
you
what
can.
That's you what can. That's what single-sex protections are about. That's what the anti-discrimination law was supposed to, sex discrimination law was supposed to have, so that we could discriminate against men in certain circumstances where we have to for our protection. So they're taking the same arguments as a trans activist while they're calling us trans activists. So it's dark.
Very odd.
Yeah. Anyways, that's all I got to say about that, as far as Gump would say.
Well, yeah, so I had something else to sort of just mention about centrism. The thing about centrism it doesn't seem to have any driving ideological force behind it,
oh.
other than like an optimism that all problems have a middle ground, that all problems, when approached with nuance, can be solved with nuance, and that everyone can walk away happy somehow. So no, there's a distribution. I think a lot of problems can probably be solved with the middle ground, but there are some things we actually do need to take a hard line on.
Women and not being men is one of them.
Yeah, like science.
He says, you know, nuance and centrist take on controversial issues, and then calls him a her.
Yeah, like science, reality. There are things that we do need to actually take a pretty hard line on at times.
Yeah,
and
women's safety, children's safety.
Safety is something we should be taking a very hard line on.
Uncompromising.
Also, you know, quality. Like, we should be asking for our analysis to be of high quality as well. So there's this false idea that you can have a middle ground solution to things. Mm-hmm. And it seems to automatically cast anyone that has an ideological framework or an analytical framework, or that comes with an uncompromising boundary. So, for example, I don't want to compromise on the admission that science is really important, or that reality is really important, or that I don't want to be lied to.
Mm-hmm.
It casts someone that has that boundary as somehow radical or extreme or dangerous or wrong.
Not nuanced.
And then there is this like pathological almost, you know, like pursuit of nuance. And it seems like it seems to be trying to create a knowledge market, right? Or a market for knowledge workers. And this is a little bit like the creation of the diversity, equity, and inclusion market. So, you know, there was, you know, that organizations like Stonewall and ACON and Human Rights Campaign play in. So they create a need. There is a need for you to educate your workers about diversity, equity, and inclusion. There's a need for you to have people come to your workplace and to speak about how to be nice and fluffy to trans people. So then that creates a market for people who can come in to deliver the training, who can deliver the talks, who can create the flags, who can create the slogans and all of that, you know, propaganda.
Yeah.
So, like, you know,
they're providing a market too for men who don't want to give up porn.
Right.
Because one of the things that Genevieve Gluck says is that at the root of this is pornography.
Yeah.
So, and I've analysed the intellectual roots as well, and I've tried to do that based on my own knowledge, and I've researched as well. Genevieve will say that that's almost not insignificant. And I've said that I think we've both talked about the way that institutional corruption has taken ideas that are useful to it, that are useful to the market, that are useful to the government. So it's not so much that they've developed ideas based on, like, you know, Weber and Marx and Durkheim sitting in their little things thinking about things. They've developed ideas for a market. And she would say that the pornography has become a massive thing for that. So they don't want to, and feminists are saying, look, part of the solution is to knock this stuff on the head. And so they don't want to say that, because they would offend a certain amount of their subscription base, right? Because it's too conservative, or it's a little bit prudish, or whatever. So then they're catering to a market.
Like, my point was slightly more that I think they're actually creating a market. Like,
for themselves. I think
they are creating a market, yeah, for themselves, for the production of nuance.
That's right, because what they have is not – what centrism is a bunch of people, which I just said, but a group of unqualified people who think they can make line calls and in between compromises. So what they do is they say, oh, this is this and this is this. Let's find a compromise. It's like a dialectic, but not one that would be negotiated with debate. You know, we're talking about the Hegelian sort of theory.
Yeah. We don't it's getting very close to critical theory there.
Well, they I always think that he's a bit of an evangelical. He looks at political theory like it's scripture, like an evangelical would look at scripture, and he says, oh, what did that person believe? But that's not how we studied primary documents of theorists in humanities. We looked at them in terms of the structure of the argument and the model of theoretical analysis. I mean, I hate to be technical, but we did have rules, and that's why when he said they've got rules, I thought, of course they've got friggin' rules. You know, I mean, I know I joke about my degree being of no use, but I didn't sit around and smoke cigarettes for 4 years. We did actually do, there is a discipline there.
You were also wearing a beret.
Yeah. I never wore a beret. I promise. I never wore a
beret. You didn't have a beret cat. And a little Frenchy striped shirt and a
tin of cat cigarettes. You know, the roll your own. And we'd smoke in the common room for hours and talk about how we're going to make the society better.
Oh, yeah, those days, yeah.
It was a very enjoyable time. I enjoyed it very much.
Yeah, so I think there is a lot of market forces at work here. And, yeah, like I said, there's a market for the creation of nuance. And like you said, they are also catering to a market. And I know from experience that I think that a lot of that young men who are probably porn consumers.
Yeah, they consume this. Podcasting is a market. You know, it's a growing market, and people.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I used to listen to a few podcasts when I was in business, and I drive around in my car, and you know, you'd want something to listen to, and I'd listen to podcasts and sermons and whatever, because you get bored. You're not going to sit down and listen to radio the whole time. So it creates a massive market among working class people who have time to listen, administrative class people. There's a whole range of people that are audiences for these guys who can make them feel better about how everything's women's faults and everything's all their porn's fine and all the progressives are assholes and so are the women.
In the video about the grievance studies affair, the professor whose name they use, there's a professor that they get, they use his name because he's a retired academic. He's a bit of a strange one. And on the video, he actually starts talking about how he got really into bodybuilding and he started looking at bodybuilding YouTubes. And then that led him into pornography about, like, made by bodybuilding women.
Mm.
And so he actually started talking and he suggested that they do a paper about bodybuilding and pornography. I thought it was just a little bit sort of uncritical.
Hindsight is one of those things. When they first came on the scene, we thought we're all desperate for some critique. I had contacted an old lecturer of mine and said, is there anyone doing feminist analysis to critique this stuff? Because, you know, you could really go to town on it. And he didn't know. He said this was probably more than 10 years ago. Maybe it was 10 years ago. He said he didn't know. So it was years later until I found the gender critical feminists and thought, this is what needs to be done. So we're not saying, I don't think that we have the only answers that are for this. We have our own little patch. We're trying to do some work. We're trying to highlight people who do the work and work out how we can get this stuff out of our institutions. It's a big job. And to critique the government, call the government to account. We don't just want to argue on the internet with people, and I have done a bit of that this week, the last couple of days particularly. But I've done that because I want to get to the bottom of what these people are saying. I want to expose them and show that their analysis is not going to be of any help to us.
That's really the important thing here. Like, we've just spent, you know, quite a bit of time sounding off about James Lindsay, and like that's a little bit fun. But it's not because we're mean, and it's not because we think he's not a very nice person or anything like that. It's because there's a marketplace of ideas and there is a limited amount of attention. And our goal is really to try to help people find something that is going to help them be effective, because we are in an existential fight against gender identity. Now, you know, I know that, you know, there's, you know, criticism about saying, about trying to say that this is like the most important fight, that there are plenty of other really important fights. So please, if you are helping women out of sex work, if you are, you know, combating porn, if you're working on domestic violence, please keep doing that, right? But there is a really important fight, and a lot of people are standing up and saying no against gender identity. And it's important that we do it in a way that is effective. Like, it's important that we listen to people who help, who try to educate us, and that we learn something when we spend our time. So, you know, it's our hope that we give people something interesting to think about, and we give some sort of different perspective, and or a helpful perspective,
yeah,
on current events and the ideas that are out floating around out there. Like, that's we're not right. here to like take up a couple of hours of your day every week and you know, make your wallet a little bit lighter. You know, we're not here because we want to have you know, a lot of Twitter followers or anything like that. Like, we're here because we really hope that we're able to help.
That's right, yeah.
You know.
And yeah. It's kind of our nature. I think both of us have kind of been drawn into this because we want to find the solution ourselves, and we want to help people find ways that they can feel useful in combating this, whether it be for children or for gays or for women. You know, it's important to us to do it. And I've read their book. And I've followed them before previously, and I've listened to what they've said. So it's not as if I haven't listened. And I've had some criticism. People say, oh, you don't know, he's done an amazing job. And I said, well, I've read their book. Have you read their book? Oh, no, I haven't read their book. Well, maybe I know more about them than you do then, you know. They want to believe the narrative, the solution is simplistic, and that they can still keep their misogyny.
If we just say, and it just seems to be, if we just say no to discourses around power.
Yeah.
Like, there is this false narrative that all discourse around power is the same discourse around power, and that all discourse around power is wrong and damaging. Yeah. And I honestly think that is going to leave women in a very bad situation if we stop talking about power.
Yeah, disparate of power sort of structures.
Because how can we talk about who has it and who doesn't,
yeah,
if doing that is somehow woke and wrong?
Well, they think it's not taking responsibility, and it's not they turn it into a personal development strategy. While my politics, I separate from my personal development strategies. And saying that some people are oppressed, and that's what I accuse Helen of being, maybe having a bit of middle-class blindness, because she was so convinced that women are not oppressed. It's like, oh, my God, just have a look at the world. And, you know, she said, yeah, it's because of my class. It's like they start to say, oh, yeah, you know, you and your woke ideas about economic class. It's, you know, so they've got complete ignorance. They just pick and choose. That's what the centrist does. They pick and choose the theories that they're happy with. And even liberalism, even if they clung to liberalism, that would make me happy. But they don't even seem to understand liberalism. They don't understand the concepts of the way the liberal society is supposed to be structured, and the checks and balances that are in the liberal state are from tyranny and corruption, and the way that ideology is meant to be out of the state. even that they don't seem to understand. So I'm sick of listening to all the things I don't understand. I wanted to just get that out. I've vented now.
And this is why we object to having diversity, equity, and inclusion education in the state.
Yes.
In the workplace.
Yeah. Right? It's a liberal,
yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, now that we've got that out of your system, I think we should just make mention that it is Trans Awareness Week again. It feels like it was just Trans Awareness Week.
Well, it was a few weeks ago, but they just made it up. They put a fact check on it. You see that? They put a fact check on it. It's not actually Trans Awareness Week. You can't just make this shit up.
And so Trans Awareness Week, for those who don't know, is a week to be aware of things in transit. Let's just, I don't know, probably things that are transitional, transportational, transitionary. And it leads up to Transgender Day of Remembrance, which
we remember all the trans people that we've killed from our hateful speech.
From our tweets. We remember all of the trans people who were murdered by our tweeting and our misgendering.
And we saw a thing, I don't know if I can put it up, a correction as well, where an Irish organisation had said that 5 trans people had been murdered, and the community notes had come up and said this figure actually includes gender diverse people, which are just people who haven't got a typical gender expression. So they're not actually trans, they're not trans identifying people, they're just people who have died in various ways and are gender diverse. Like they're so desperate for the oppression, for the proof of the oppression, that they just go, they fall into making stuff up.
In Sydney, the Gender Centre sponsored Eloise Brooks, I believe it was, to do a podcast called Counting the Dead. That was a couple of years ago now. And so he went off and he actually flew to around to a few different states to actually go and look at like deep archival material. So he had to go back until like around the 60s to find trans identified people who'd been murdered in Australia. And so their solution now to Transgender Day of Remembrance is because they have a vigil and they have to read out the names, right? And so,
what service?
They have to read out all the names of the transgender people who've been murdered by our tweets every year. And, of course, there aren't any because you can't be murdered by a tweet. And the Trans Murder Monitoring Project counted 4 trans-identified people who'd been murdered in Australia in the last 14 years, right? One of whom was a female drag king, and 3 of whom were sex workers, I believe. So anyway, what Eloise Brooks does is he actually says, look, if you're trans or gender diverse and you've died, we'll read your name out. So if you die for any reason and you are trans or in any way gender wonky or gender non-committal, they will read your name out at the vigil. So yeah. You know, it's
nice or something. Yeah,
it's a bit of community for them, you know. It's all right.
It's a desperate attempt to prop up a false narrative for a bogus class.
But I do have some news related to trans murder. And that is that on the, I think it was the ABC reported on the 10th of November, that 50-year-old Kylie So, a trans-identified Cambodian New Zealand sex worker, who was tried for the murder of a 71-year-old farmer, Robert Dickey,
has just been...
That's what?
Male person.
A male person, yeah. So two male people. Kylie So has been found not guilty of the murder of Robert Dickey. So this is one of those, it's a bit of a rare finding, in that the Crown prosecution, they did have a bit of evidence, like there was blood and signs of a struggle in Mr. Dickey's bedroom, and their theory was that he contracted Kylie So to come and stay with him for some sort of services, and maybe, you know, there was some sort of altercation and Kylie struck him. There was a struggle. He was killed because he's, you know, probably 71. And then Kylie fed his body to the pigs.
How lovely.
Yeah. So the judge concluded that there was not really enough evidence that the body was fed to the pigs, and that Kylie So seems like a nice kind of a person who probably wasn't very violent. There's a plausible alternate theory that the victim might have gone to meet with bikies later in the day and they have killed him.
It's all very sinister, isn't it? We don't need to sort of go that far to look for evidence that women are murdered, which we did sort of point out to Helen that there is verifiable evidence here that women have oppression, but they really do, they give it the red hot go, don't they? Particularly on Trans Week of a Day of Remembrance and Trans Awareness Week. So gird your loins. We've also got a little picture that tweet that Mole has put out where he's all in for the Trans Day of Awareness, which would be a more noble cause, let me say.
Yeah, I think it's really important to be aware of trains and
their service to society.
Where would we be without them?
Yeah. Mm. There's something about you wanted to mention about our friend Gillian Spencer.
Oh, I did. I did want to mention this. Yes, I just wanted to give a bit of a shout out to our friend Dr. Gillian Spencer. So she has organized a huge number of her fellow clinicians to create an open letter that was sent to every New South Wales MP on the 5th of November. And it is titled An Open Letter from Clinicians Concerned About the New South Wales Government's Flawed Framework for Gender Treatment Services for Children and Young People. And it opens, we are writing to you because of our serious professional concerns regarding the New South Wales Government framework. And it goes on to basically detail the problems with the New South Wales endorsed framework for treating children with gender dysphoria. And it talks about the reliance on the WPATH and the AusPATH guidelines and the problems with them. So this letter and it being sent to the MPs was the basis for an article by Bernard Lane in The Australian a couple of days ago. The letter itself has actually been posted up on the Women's Rights Network Australia website, and we'll put a link to that and the Australian article in the show notes. So I encourage you to check it out and to get across the issues that, because you may not know that the New South Wales government, which is the Labor government, is right now planning to consider banning conversion therapy. So, of course, the problem with this is that we know it can mean two things, right? Banning gay conversion therapy. Right? Most of us are reasonably fine with, you know,
we're against, yeah.
Most of us don't want gay people to be.
No. And, you know,
tortured.
We would hope that there would be very little of that anyways. And yeah, a good chunk of it's already illegal.
Yeah, like, you know, tortured or gaslit or, you know, told that they're doing the wrong thing or anything like that, you know. But then there's also another meaning, which is trans conversion therapy. So as we all know, if your daughter tells you she's a lesbian, all you need to do is say, good on you, you know, that's it, and she can live a happy, healthy life. If your daughter tells you that she is a man, you are obliged to try to start her on puberty blockers, which will stunt her growth and have future issues with her bone density, cross-sex hormones, which will make her sterile, which will make her give her irreversible bodily changes, binders, which will damage her spine, damage her ribs, damage her breasts, mastectomy, which is irreversible, and, you know, possibly even going down to phalloplasty. Like, these are all
And Gillian Spencer would have has highlighted this as well. The reason she lost her position or she's been suspended is because she's raised concerns and saying, well, some of these kids are just gay, and they can be helped to come to terms with their sex without any medical intervention. And almost all of them will find that puberty is a cure to dysphoria. And some of it is being taught on and they've been groomed online. So we need to actively stop it. And the actively stopping of people seeking out these harmful medical treatments is called conversion therapy, would be covered. So trying That's to right. stop them access these harmful, which are being increasingly banned around the world, these therapies. So as we find, these pernicious little acts that they put in, they pretend that they're for gay people, and they're not. They're actually promoting gay conversion therapy in the most brutal way, to turn someone from turn someone to the opposite sex requires intervention that is extremely, the risk factors are massive, massive.
So in our opinion, you know, this like trans therapy, it is potentially another type. It's a modern gay conversion.
That's right.
Right. However, the trans lobby would say that, you know, talking therapy, exploratory therapy, and any sort of not acquiescing to the demands is conversion therapy. So
more trans people.
The New South Wales government are going to be considering banning conversion therapy in like the coming weeks, essentially, and it's really important that our MPs become acquainted with the issues and that they become au fait with the difference between gay conversion and trans conversion. Very different. So thank you very much, Gillian Spencer, and we'll put a link to that in the notes below. Will we wrap it up there?
I think so. Yeah. We've ranted, tick. We've promoted things, tick.
We've talked about Trans Awareness Week. Tick, tick, tick. All right. Good. Yeah. All right. So thank you for joining us in the dollhouse. Please like, share, comment, and subscribe. Our podcast is on YouTube, Spotify, and Google Podcasts, and our show notes are on Substack. I'm Kit Kowalski, and I'm here with Edie Wyatt. We'll be back next week with the news and views in the Aussie genderverse.
Thanks, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Live fast, die young, bad girls do it well. Live fast, die young, bad girls do it well. Live fast, die young.